the important, so this patient need blood, so because he has lost more than 30% of blood. So if somebody is coming with a low blood pressure and tachycardia in trauma, need blood. In class 4, like more than 40% need, anyway, they need blood and massive transfusion as well. This is just an illustration, like these are not exact amounts, but probable amount they can lose with some of these fractures. So what are you going to do for the circulation? So you have put the patient into the monitor, the cardiac monitor as well. And if you see external hemorrhages, you have to apply the point pressure. And in certain instances where the expertise there might have to go for arterial tourniquets as well. But make sure in emergency departments, we recommend applying point pressure for arterial injuries. And you have to establish IV lights, large bore cannula, like at least 17 gauge to the antecubital fossa. And for the volume resuscitation, you don't need central lines. The peripheral lines are the best to resuscitate volumes, not the central line. So you need only peripheral lines for volume resuscitation in trauma. And to monitor the volume resuscitation, you can apply catheters. And also, if you need immediate blood transfusions, you can have rapid infusers if available. And so intervention wise, there's a, like earlier we thought we can give isotonic, warm isotonic fluids more than 1 liter. Now it says give only one. So there's a judicial fluid management now. So you give only 1 liter. Earlier thought we can give like at least one and a half liters, but not now. So you give 1 liter. If the patient is not improving at the end of the 1 liter, the next step is blood. So make sure you use blood early. As I said, like if the admission, the patient is falling into the category 3, to get down the blood. And also with the early usage of blood products, which will prevent coagulopathy and thrombocytopenia, which will be a complication in trauma management later. And also aggressive fluid resuscitation is not a substitute for definitive control of hemorrhage. So if the patient is bleeding, if you, however much you resuscitate, it won't work. So you need to have definitive treatment modalities available when you are resuscitating. And failure to respond crystalloids and blood will need immediate definitive interventions. And patient with hemodynamic instability cannot go to a radiology department. And there's a concept of damage control resuscitation, which is mainly talking about the torso trauma, and the patient who has head injury does not fall into this resuscitation. Only patient who has chest and abdominal injuries. So there are three things, I'm not going to detail, but so we will have a hypotensive resuscitation, that is to maintain a blood pressure where you can keep the organ perfusion with low blood pressure and with low risk of bleeding. And also, as I said earlier, early blood and blood transfusion, that's hemostatic resuscitation. And also a damage control surgery, which is a very brief surgery to control the hemorrhage and contain the spillage. And the patient will go to the ICU for definitive, and then patient comes for the definitive surgery. Coagulopathy is one of the complications we have with management of trauma victims. So it's like in 30% of severe trauma, they will have evidence of coagulopathy. So if the patient is on anticoagulants, you need to reverse the coagulation, anticoagulants, and also point of care testing and TEMP has had huge impact in determining clotting deficiencies and appropriate component transfusion. So with the TEMP and TEC, you can transfuse exact amount of clotting factors in exact way, so patient won't be overloading. The role of calcium, it's again debatable. So if there is evidence of low calcium, can can give calcium, but when the patient is getting blood, sometimes you don't need to give calcium. And hypothermia, this is very important for us. Again, it's a part of the lethal threat as well. Like if you have the hypothermia, again, it will cause coagulopathy. In trauma, there are many ways the patient will have coagulopathy. One is dilutional coagulopathy, because you give a lot of isotonic fluids, and also you have the consumptive coagulopathy as well, and also the trauma-induced coagulopathy, it's something different than these things, and also the hypothermia, everything could cause coagulopathy. So avoid hypothermia, so you need infusion of warm saline, warm blood, and patient warming as well. According to the CRASH II trial, the tranexamic acid in trauma victims has survival benefit if you give the infusion in first 3 hours. So it will be given as like loading dose, 1 gram in 10 minutes, and also infusion for over 8 hours. And when we moving on to the disability, so you do a brief neurological examination, that's like GCS and pupil size and reactivity and blood sugar levels. In GCS, so usage of GCS, you can categorize the head injury according to the severity, like GCS 13, 14, 15 categorized as minor, 12 to 9 categorized as moderate, and less than 8 to categorize as severe head injury. And there are a few changes in the latest ALTLS, like we have there's a new entities not testable. So earlier we didn't have this non-testable in GCS. In exposure, so make sure you completely expose the patient, and also you have to lock roll the patient to examine the spine and the back. And when you expose the patient, make sure the patient is not hypothermic, and you have to use methods to prevent hypothermia. In log rolling, there are a few methods we have described in different sections, either 4-person log roll or 5-person. So I think like we have used to do 5-person log roll, but in ATLS they are describing a 4-person log roll. And with the primary survey, there are a few adjuncts. So I'm not going to talk everything, but you know, you do the pulse oximetry, ECG, blood gas and capnography, and we are indicated urinary catheters, and we are indicated gastric catheters. And I'll be talking a few things about the ultrasound. This has the fast or focused assessment with sonography in trauma, and extended fast. So these things has done major so this has happened in like detected so many intra-abdominal injuries using the FAST and EFAST. So usually FAST comprised of 4 views, the cardiac and the upper right upper quadrant, left upper quadrant, supra pubic. In extended FAST, you do the lung bases as well. So in FAST, the goal is to identify free fluid. And also if you do the chest scan to detect pneumothorax, so there are a few signs where you can identify the pneumothorax. So if you usually between the liver and spleen, you see the fluid, blackish fluid line where the free fluid is indicated. And also when you do the chest ultrasound, the normal ultrasound is the C show, where it's like a C and the show. But in pneumothorax, there are specific ultrasound features. One is, we call this as barcode. So you don't see a C and show, you talk of as barcode, and there are like sliding signs, lump points, there are a few things described. So this has impacted in a good way to detect pneumothorax with ultrasound. So once you do the primary survey, if the patient is unstable, you have to go for theaters to definitive management. And also if the patient is stable, you can continue the secondary survey. So you get a history, that's ample history of allergies, medications, past history, last means, and the events followed. And also you have to do the thorough physical examination to find what kind of injury this patient is having. Make sure you assess again these patients frequently, and also once you do, you can go for the diagnostic studies. And there are a few things like notify the head injury, like battle signs, hemotin venom, and recognize. And some of the common things we have seen, like seat belt sign, which indicate there may be abdominal or chest injuries. And so the diagnostic aids, you do the bloods with food counts, electrolytes, and creatinines. And also, once the patient is stable, you get the series of trauma radio, trauma x-rays, like chest x-ray, pelvis, and also the CT scans. So once the patient goes to the radiology, you may be able to find some of the things like here, the pelvic fractures and head injuries like hematoma. So once you see all these things, the patient will be referred to the specialty or subspecialty. So the next step, so once you have come to a diagnosis, you have to dispose the patient from resus area to either to a ward or to ICU. In certain centers where you don't have the specialty, sometimes you might have to transfer this patient. So when you are transferring, make sure patient will be transferred according to the guidelines, like and all these transfers should be coordinated effects, and receiving end should be notified, because we have seen a lot of things. Critical ill patients just coming to the ETU without notifying. So it's very difficult for us sometimes. So if you can, somebody can give a call and say, this kind of patient is coming to the ETU, that will be beneficial for the patient. So, and also the other thing, you don't need to hurry, but you have to stabilize prior to the transfer. So, and as in summary, so I just wanted to highlight a few things. The trauma is best managed by a team approach and not an individual basis. And a thorough primary and secondary survey is the key to identify life-threatening injuries. And once the life-threatening injury is discovered, intervention should not be delayed. And the disposition determined by the patient's condition as well as the available resources.